Thank you very much for having me here. Thank you for the invitation. Because we are now at a rather early time of the day, I have something to wake you up. This is a screenshot from the European Parliament website prepared for the next information campaign before the elections to the European Parliament. And they argue that this time is different. And let me ask you a question. This is particular to those of you who have been studying European Parliament election for so many years. How many times did you already hear this, that this time is different, that each subsequent election to the European Parliament is different? The 2004 election was to be different because it was held in the EU25. Okay, then the 2009 election was also to be different because, again, the Parliament got even more powers for the Treaty of Lisbon. But as we know, nothing changed to the overall description of the European Parliament as a second-order dull event of little political significance. And the 2014, we see the same. So the same arguments that this time is going to be different. So what arguments do those people have who argue that this is going to be different? Here's a screenshot from The Guardian, early November, which reports that British Prime Minister David Cameron apparently does not like Martin Schulz as the candidate for the president of the European Commission, and that he's willing to block his candidacy for the bid for the European, for the president of the European Commission. Now, no matter how we interpret this fact, it would have been not possible had the Euro parties not started their procedure to select a candidate for the president of the European Commission. And this is precisely the topic of my presentation today. So I'm gonna talk about not the pluses and minuses of the whole proposal, but how Euro parties want to implement this idea to propose a candidate for the president of the European Commission and how to promote him. And I'll do that in three steps. First, I'll explain the role of Euro parties as campaign coordinators, basing primarily on the previous record that they had before in the past, prior to 2014. Then I'll spend a while on explaining the question of selecting a leading candidate, and I'll focus on campaigning for him or her. So the ideas, the strategies, and the tools that Euro parties want to implement in order to promote that candidate. And the basis I have here is analysis of the primary secondary documents and a set of interviews that I did 3 weeks ago in Brussels with a few representatives of the major Euro parties. So let me start with this one, and I'll cover it only briefly because I think this audience is well aware of these issues. Now, to that moment, Euro parties played only very limited role in European Parliament elections. And the reasons why this was the case had to do both with institutional and internal reasons. Now, institutional reasons are pretty obvious. Again, to this audience, I don't need to explain this. There's a lack of incentives for classic party competition at the European level. So from that point of view, the role of Euro parties might be simply redundant. But there are also internal problems, that is division and constraints within the Euro parties themselves, having primarily to do with a lack of visible demand for a greater role of Euro parties as campaign coordinators. So Euro parties could play an important role, for example, as far as the coordination of activities before the European councils are concerned, but there is no demand from national political parties that Euro parties play a bigger role in the elections. So that were the primary reasons. Nevertheless, they all tried with some means to build a brand of Euro parties in the elections, and there were primarily two or three major tools. The first, of course, was famous Euro manifestos, famous because they were adopted so painstakingly within the Euro parties and later on not used, not mentioned in the election itself. They also prepared various gadgets, T-shirts, typical, I would say, as I said, gadgets for the elections. And they also tried to organize exchanges of views between the campaign coordinators, so exchanges of best practices. But because of various reasons, as I mentioned before, they were simply not very active. And the role of Euro parties could be simply said, OK, they were service provider, acting only if requested, and bearing in mind that this request did not come very often. And the content they provided was in the manifesto, as I said, not very often used in the election national campaigns, and also services like exchange of views, some tools, So from that point of view, they did not have an easy ground to build, both from the point of view of the institutional factors and internal problems. And before 2014 elections, as you all know, there were two proposals how the role could be more important. One was already rejected. That was the so-called DAF proposal, which aimed to create a pan-European constituency to elect a small portion of MEPs. So that is already done. Maybe for 2019 they will return to these issues. But another proposal remained on the table and is now activated by all the Europe parties. That is basically to select a leading candidate for President of the European Commission. And the very first thing that is important here is how they want to select that candidate. And here we see a great variety of options. The European Greens are the most advanced and most revolutionary because they all opt for an open online primary. So everybody who has green values can actually participate. And the other parties, I would say, are more traditional in the sense of giving most powers to elect a candidate to the national member parties. But some of them remain skeptical to the whole proposal, and here is a problem. Okay, because I would say as much as the four biggest Euro parties are quite optimistic, all, maybe not all, but many smaller parties at European level are not. So what happens if only a few parties, only a few Euro parties select a candidate? And I give you an example here of Party of European Left, that is radical left, communist, and various radical left parties, and they don't believe that this new measure can change anything, can democratize the European Parliament elections. But most of them will still want to select a candidate just for publicity effects. The European Parliament has already started preparations to various debates, televised debates. One of them will take place in Strasbourg, some other in Brussels. These debates, as I said, will be web streamed and put online on the EBS. This is a television of the European Union. And the European Parliament will promote it in the national media. So Euro parties don't want to lose a chance for a free publicity. So from that point of view, many of them will simply have that candidate, no matter the way how he is elected. And I mentioned before the Euro Manifesto, so showing that they don't really have a place in this election. And here, given this new measure to select a candidate, Euro Manifesto can, for the first time, be used in the election. Because the common understanding in most Euro parties is that the European Euro Manifesto should be a basis, a programmatic basis for these candidates. In other words, that they should accept those manifestos if they want to run as a leading candidate of the Euro Party. So we see that thanks to this new measure, which many people believe is really limited, not revolutionary, Euro parties really now show the relevance of various techniques, various tools they were doing for so many years, and the manifesto is here. A very important document, and hopefully this will be, as I said, used by the candidates in this election. So we see that we are now going closer to the parliamentary model, a responsible party model, at least on this part, that a candidate for the major position in the European Union will have a program on which, at least, of course, in theory, the voters will be able to judge his plans and then primarily hold him accountable. What is the problem in terms of campaigning? Now I move to the part on campaigning. There's a huge discrepancy in the amount of funds that Euro parties receive. They are all funded by the European Parliament in 85%, and in 15% they are funded from the national member parties' fees. And as you can see from this figure, the two largest Euro parties clearly outnumber all the others in terms of amount of subsidies they have. So the biggest EPP yearly budget is about 8 million euros, whereas the smaller ones, as you can see here, got about 300,000 euros. And that is normally spent on administration and daily, day-to-day activities, so very little actually remains for the election campaign. So we can't expect, just because of the financial reasons, that the smaller Euro parties will do anything else than participate in those debates with other candidates. So we can't expect they will go actually on tour to a number of European countries to promote their candidate. So this is really, really important problem here. But I said, the first four parties, you could really think that they can try at least to have some activities. And what is the a major task of my research here at this stage. In order to explain the role of Europartis, I try to combine two bodies of literature. One is the literature on Europartis, and another one is a literature on political communication. Because, as I said, if Europartis are treated as a campaign organization, we need to take into account also those lessons. And there are a number of tools in the political communication literature that I think can help to understand the role of Europartis as campaign players. Normally, the basis of their analysis in the people who study political communication are both so-called objective and subjective data. Objective data is that there are measures that you can easily compare and put into numbers, that is election budget, a number of activities. You can simply see it by observing a campaign. I can't do that yet. I can't do it yet because the campaign has not started, of course. And the other measure they use is those called subjective measures, in which basically they ask campaign coordinators, campaign managers, for subjective opinions on the level and the degree of using certain instruments. And did I already did it, asking by the plans. And what do we see here? What do we see as campaign strategy and campaign tools are concerned? You would expect, at least, this would be the hypothesis that you could make, that the biggest Euro parties, that the most pro-European parties, will invest most resources in building a space, a coordination centrum in Brussels. So in other words, that they will try to coordinate the campaign from Brussels, because they are pro-European, they believe in the various ideas of European Union, pro-federalistic, and so on. They would like to do it from Brussels to build a brand. Whereas all the other parties, particularly those who are more Eurosceptic, they would rather invest the resources in the member states. In other words, try to help their member parties as much as possible to coordinate those activities at the national level. What I have found here from, as I said, from this early analysis is that is not the case always. Namely, the two Euro parties, okay, they invest in building up resources in the European at the in Brussels level to build up their own offices, to increase the number of participants and employees in the campaign. But some even pro-European parties have a completely different strategy. The case is ALDE, European Liberals, a very pro-European family, does not believe, they are at least the managers of the campaign, that they should be actually increasing their resources in Brussels. They want to go down. They want to help their member parties at the lowest possible level by giving them expertise, various techniques for campaign, and so on and so on. So this hypothesis cannot be held, at least from this early analysis, okay? So I was surprised, I must say, because I see a change of accents from the previous campaign. So, but the EPP and PS are investing a lot. Just to give you an example, the EPP will have its own war room, as they call it, and 20 new people are employed to this war room from January to June. And the number of people that currently work in the EPP is about 40, so adding 20 new people is a big amendment. And this is precisely the question that I put here on the slide, centralization versus decentralization of campaign. How can Europartis be relevant to these member parties? As I said, we have those dilemma here. And from my analysis that I conducted, it is quite clear that most of these Europartis will focus on promoting a candidate in the media. So that would be quite different, maybe not completely different, but quite different from what normally what you expect at the national level. And the reasons, of course, are quite obvious. Promoting a candidate in the media is necessary to get, as they say, a change of attitude from the national media, and they don't believe they actually can go on and rallying on the streets in all EU member states because of lack of time. If the campaign starts in March and ends up in May, they have only 2 months, and normally, that is, as I said, they believe it's not enough. And the problem also is that if the candidate of the Europarty wants to go to one of the member states, he or she needs to get an invitation from one of the national member parties. And that won't be always the case. And give you an example. If, for example, ALDE, European Liberals, elect so-called austerity candidate, pro-austerity candidate, that is unlikely that they will be invited to Greece, okay? Because austerity as a measure is rather badly regarded in Greece. So the key thing is to what extent those candidates can actually get those invitations to go there and to be visible, to make some conferences, to speak to the press, and be present on the national media. But from that point of view, they won't rather do much railing on the street, perhaps with exception of the PS, because the PS is in a good position, because unlike other parties, it has the so-called PS activists, 20,000 of young militants from all over Europe who believe in European ideas and want to be close to the PS, and they are PS activists. We could call it quasi-membership. And these people will be used to promote that candidate in the national media. And the last thing I'm considering here is whether the so-called measures of professionalism of political campaigns can be used, can be adapted to discuss the question of the Euro parties. And there are a few indexes that I use here. For example, one is party-centered theory of professionalism and the so-called Kamprof index. This is a 30-point index which measures the degree of professionalism. And there are other indexes. And those indexes that measure, as I said, the degree of professionalism mostly focus on the use of the so-called new media, new social media. And surprisingly, Euro parties do rather well on these indexes. I was really surprised, because as I said, if those indexes are focused on checking, for example, whether they have intranet, whether they use telemarketing, whether they have opposition research practices, whether they actually ask PR agency for help, then surprisingly, all Euro parties do. To a greater or lesser extent, they all have opposition research centers. For example, the EPP uses the help of its foundation. So the foundation is dealing with checking on the opposition. All the major four parties have contracts with peer agencies, the Greens, the European Liberals, EPP, and the PS. They, from time to time, commission opinion polls on the market to check on various tendencies and find out more details about the strategy. But the one difference that is clear is that they won't do any micro-targeting or narrow-casting activities, primarily because they don't know who should they target, what the target is, so that is left to the national member parties. So although we could see that, as I said, there are some differences, I was surprised that all from the point of view of the use of new media and from the point of view of following those best practices, advices coming out of what professional campaigning means, with a few reservations which control for the differences in the EU and national political systems, those Euro parties are quite professionalized, so to say. As I said, to the limitations, we know that this is completely different, but they at least know about the various techniques, the plan is advanced, and they want to use it in the campaign. So to conclude, we see a big development. I think that the selection of candidates, the proposal activated, reinvigorated Euro parties, gave them some new push to the previous activities. And now, as I said, at this moment, unfortunately, the research is really going on as we are talking about a moving object. So I can't tell more, but from what I did already, as I said, I see that this is going to be an interesting exchange of views, and that the question is how Euro parties will manage to show its relevance to the member parties and to show that they can actually help and promote a candidate using the contemporary techniques of professional campaigning. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.